Learning about our past isn't just interesting, it's important in helping us shape the future. Our city's 150th anniversary, or sesquicentennial, is an opportunity to celebrate the pride and vision of our founder, General William Jackson Palmer, along with so many other people and events contributing to our progress and growth. This UCCS lecture series illuminates the role the university has played in our community's history and how it will continue to shape Colorado Springs for generations to come.
Thank you, Mayor Southers. All of us at the University of Colorado, Colorado Springs, are honored to be part of this year-long celebration of the 150th anniversary of Colorado Springs. As we celebrate this milestone in the history of Colorado Springs, I'm grateful to have been part of the Colorado Springs community for almost 30 years. I watched Colorado Springs grow, and I've had the pleasure of watching UCCS grow right along with it. There is a sense of community created by our shared history, and that is what makes every community different. Our history is what makes Colorado Springs unique. This lecture series will highlight the role that UCCS has played in shaping our community during the past 56 years, and how our UCCS faculty, staff, students, and alumni will continue to shape Colorado Springs for the next 150 years.
Thank you, Mayor Southers and Chancellor Reddy, for that fantastic introduction. My name is Lynn Vidler, and I'm the Dean of the College of Letters, Arts, and Sciences at UCCS. Thanks for spending part of your Thursday evening with us. Tonight's presentation, Chasing the Cure, the Archaeology of Cragmor Tuberculosis Sanatorium, is the second part of the UCCS mini lecture series celebrating Colorado Springs' sesquicentennial. I've only been at UCCS for a short time, so I'm excited to learn more about the history of our beautiful campus. In just a few moments, we'll enjoy our keynote presentation from Dr. Karen Larkin. Following the presentation, two current UCCS students and a UCCS alumna will share their perspectives on the history and archaeology of Cragmor and their experiences working on this project. At the end of the program, we will have some time to answer your questions. Before we begin, I'd like to take a moment to orient you to our Zoom webinar. There should be two buttons on the bottom of your screen, chat and Q&A. Following the formal presentation, there will be a question and answer session with Dr. Larkin and our panel. Please use the Q&A button throughout tonight's program to submit questions for the panel. Please note that we may not have a chance to answer all of the submitted questions, but we'll do our best to get in as many as possible in the time allotted. We'll also get to your pre-submitted questions as well. If you'd like to make comments to the entire group during the program, use the chat button and select the All Panelists and Attendees dropdown before sharing your comment. We love to see conversations flowing in the chat. If you have any technical issues, please use the chat button, select the All Panelists dropdown, type in your query, and someone will assist you. All right, let's get on with the program. Our presenter, Dr. Karen Larkin has nearly 25 years of archaeological and museum experience in the US West and Southwest. She led the archaeological survey and testing program on the UCCS campus beginning in 2016 as part of a series of History Colorado State Historical Fund grants to examine both prehistoric and historic sites in the area. Currently, as an assistant professor and curator of the Archaeology Curation Facility at UCCS, Dr. Larkin teaches both anthropology and museum studies classes. Her research focuses on decolonizing methodologies, understanding community interactions, archaeologies of health and tourism, social change, and negotiating social discord through material culture. She is co-editor of The Archaeology of Class War, published in 2009 by the University Press of Colorado, and has published numerous book chapters and articles on archaeology throughout the West and Southwest. Without further ado, please welcome Dr. Larkin.
Well, thank you, Dean Vidler. I'm going to share my screen with you so I can share some lovely photos. So last month, Provost Emeritus Peg Bacon talked about the history of UCCS, and tonight we're going to step back in time and explore what it was like here before Cragmor became part of the CU system. I want to share some recent research that we have been conducting on Cragmor Tuberculosis Sanatorium as part of a larger campus archaeology project. This work benefits from past archival research by Douglas McKay, Missy Bonds, Judith Rice Jones, and many others, as well as an archaeological survey conducted by William Arbogast in 1998. We've built on this foundation, conducting additional archaeological and ethnographic investigations as part of a History Colorado State Historical Fund grant. Before I jump into my presentation, I want to take a moment to recognize the original occupants and stewards of this land. Indigenous peoples have been living here for at least 10,000 years, and the area was the homeland to a number of tribes, including the ones listed on here on this slide. I would like to start my presentation with an acknowledgement and recognition that they still have a presence and tie to this land. And we ask that you respect this history and not disturb the archaeological remains you may see while you move around campus. The UCCS campus has at least 42 recorded archaeological sites, which include ones that relate to the indigenous occupation of this land, as well as those related to the development of Colorado Springs. In this talk, I focus on sites related to Cragmor Sanatorium. So let me start by giving you a little background. As Matt Mayberry once noted, Colorado Springs was built on two industries, tourism and tuberculosis. During the first half of the 20th century, Colorado Springs enjoyed a worldwide reputation as a health mecca for people with tuberculosis because of its acclaimed healing climate. I'm going to use TB here to refer to tuberculosis because it's much easier to say. So starting around 1890s, TB sanatoriums began to spring up along the outskirts of town, and Cragmor Sanatorium was one of those. The sanatorium was the brainchild of a prominent TB physician, Edwin Sully, who convinced General Palmer to donate the land and $50,000 to fund the construction of a new type of sanatorium along Austin's Bluffs, one that focused on fresh air, rest, isolation, and good food. Cragmor officially opened its doors in 1905, but unfortunately, Dr. Sully died only a year later. Dr. Forrester took Dr. Sully's original idea and redesigned a sanatorium to cater to wealthy and famous tuberculosis patients from across the country. And under the guidance of Drs. Webb and Forrester, Cragmor grew and established a reputation as a luxury sanatorium. The history of the sanatorium is very interesting and very colorful, and you can read about it in Doug McKay's book, Asylum of the Gilded Pill. The picture is covered here, or the cover is pictured here. The history includes housing movie stars, famous authors, artists, musicians, alleged mafioso, and millionaires through the 1920s, but the stock market crash and the Great Depression heavily impacted Cragmor's clientele, and the facility went into decline during the 1930s and 40s. In 1952, Cragmor Foundation signed a contract with the Department of Health, Education, and Welfare in conjunction with the Bureau of Indian Affairs to treat Navajo patients with TB. This sustained the facility until it closed its doors in 1962, and at this point, the sanatorium was transferred to the regions of the University of Colorado to become part of the CU system. After this, much of the original history was subsumed under the growing campus, but we are interested in how much of this colorful history we can still see in the archaeological record. Luckily, some of the material, culture, and structures of the sanatorium remain. And in 2016, I received a State Historical Fund grant to develop a historic preservation plan for the campus. The first step in this process involved an archaeological survey and testing project. This allowed us to further study the remains of the sanatorium before more was lost to campus growth. William Arbogast, I noted, did the original campus survey, and we revisited six of those originally recorded sites to collect more data. We also identified a couple of additional sites associated with the sanatorium. From this, we were able to learn more, not just about the history, but also about the daily life and healing strategies at Cragmor Sanatorium, which I'm going to share with you. By combining archaeological and archival evidence, we were able also to evaluate some of the more colorful stories of the sanatorium. So during the early 1900s, doctors didn't have antibiotics. They did, however, have many theories about how to treat TB. Most of those ideas revolved around isolating people with TB, that might sound familiar right now, minimizing environmental factors, and enhancing overall health through rest, rich foods, exposure to unpolluted dry air, sunshine, and light exercise. Sunlight and fresh air were prominent therapies. Colorado Springs was nationally renowned for its healing climate because of the clean mountain air, the lack of industrial pollution, and the, on average, about 300 days of sunshine each year. You can see the importance placed on sunlight in this health and sunlight ad here at the top right that reads, quote, "Sunlight kills germs and heals diseased tissue," end quote. This theory led doctors to recommend sunbathing, which happened on the rooftop garden area of Dr. Forrester's newly renovated sanatorium shown here. Another doctor, Dr. Verba, also developed a device on the left called a laryngoscope, which was designed to direct UV light in the form of sunlight down a patient's throat, which he claimed was the most powerful remedy. Food was another remedy for patients who were wasting away due to TB. In fact, one of the terms used for TB was consumption because the disease seemed to consume the patient who appeared to waste away. One treatment for that involved what they called stuffing. In stuffing, they plied patients with rich foods to help them grow stronger. And during the 1920s, patients produced a newsletter for the sanatorium called 98.6. That provided entertainment, local gossip, and a very informative section in which patients could ask Dr. Forrester questions pertaining to their treatment. In a newsletter dated to September 13, 1928, one patient asked, quote, "Do you think I should drink 2 or 3 quarts of milk a day?" end quote. This question likely stemmed from the practice of stuffing, in which patients were encouraged to drink lots of milk and eat a dozen eggs a day to grow strong. Dr. Forrester responded that, quote, "Milk is one of the most valuable foods we have," end quote, but he also goes on to note that it can upset patients' stomachs. So he only recommends 3 to 4 glasses a day unless you're under the care of a stomach specialist. In the archaeological record, we did indeed find evidence of this with the milk bottle caps and covers that are shown here. The sanatorium brought in fresh milk and cream from local dairies during this time, and they have their own branding. The dining experience for Cragmor patients was also lavish. Historic accounts recall luxurious dining experience of patients during the 19-teens, 20s, and 30s, and advertising for Cragmor states that food was served on real china with monogrammed napkins and silver trays. Our archaeological investigations found some evidence of this dining experience. Pictured here, you can see a fragment from one of the china bowls that bears Cragmor's monogram, the C and the S encircled on it, as well as a silver-plated knife. Another prominent theory was that light exercise in the fresh air was therapeutic to TB patients. To this end, one sanatorium doctor named Dr. Houck created the 3-mile walking trail for patients to hike during recovery. While the dry Colorado climate and sunlight were thought to be therapeutic, elevation didn't seem to be an important factor, even though many of these patients were coming from lower elevations. The archival records note that this 3.1-mile-long trail was dubbed Houck's Trail But patients sometimes called it the Happy Trail or even the High Trail to Passion. And the more colorful names stem from the fact that the patients would steal away on romantic trysts and consume alcohol on this remote path. Based on the archival record and the oral histories, we know that the trail was designed to encircle Austin's Bluffs, and Houck engineered it to be on level or relatively flat. So maybe elevation was a factor after all. Additionally, records note that he installed distance markers and rock cairns lining the trail to give direction. The trail fell out of use in the 1930s, became overgrown, and the majority of it was lost over time. However, a portion of the trail still exists behind the administrative buildings on campus and can be accessed via an unused overgrown staircase pictured here, which has since been removed by campus facilities. In our survey, we identified two carved stones also that we believe acted as trail markers and directional signs. One boulder had a carved three that you can see here on the right, and the other a carved square with a semicircle hollow section is on the left. We believe that the three rock, or the three carved rock, was the end of the trail that marked mile three. We don't know the meaning of the other rock, but we're open to suggestions or any information anybody might have. We're also curious where the trail might have gone. So in order to try to identify the most likely path of the original Happy Trail, one of our students at the time, Caitlin Conchin, created a predictive model. And to do this, she used the archaeological remains, historic photographs, archival documents, and a predictive modeling function in ArcGIS. Caitlin used the points we identified as remnants of the Happy Trail, including the three rock along with the documented descriptions as the basis for a predictive model. The map shown here she produced using the Tobler hiking function, which measures walking speed as a function of ground slope. In other words, the path is the least costly one in terms of the time it would take to walk based on the ground slope, which would approximate Houck's engineered level path. The model placed the path through Garden Ranch, which was referenced in the archival record, and it also matched apparent footpaths visible on a 1947 aerial photograph of the area, which is not pictured here. So now we had an approximate path. We had to now ground truth our model. Using the predicted route, we located the UTM coordinates of where the other 2 mile markers should have occurred by measuring back from the end three rock marker. We then used those coordinates to see if we could locate portions of the path or other stone markers on the ground. We successfully located an additional carved rock near where the mile two marker should have been. And it's in an open space in Garden Ranch area, which is a housing development built on land previously owned by Dr. Houck. We're not sure what the carving on this rock represents, but we know it wasn't put there naturally. And unfortunately, the mile one marker lies under where Union Boulevard meets Austin Bluffs now. And that construction severely disturbed the area. So unsurprisingly, we weren't able to locate any markers in this area, but we still believe our model was successful. In addition to these holistic treatment approaches, doctors used more traditional medicines to treat TB at Cragmor. These bottles give you an idea of some of the medicinal practices used during the 1910s through the 30s. So moving from left to right, the bottle in the first two photographs from the left is a graduated cough syrup bottle that you can barely see the graduated marks on the sides, indicating ounce and cc measurements. I've labeled them with red arrows for you. The bottle base, seen on the far left, has an Illinois Glass Company mark, which is the eye with inside of the diamond shape, and under that, the Lyric Maker's mark, which was reserved for these graduated medicine bottles. And this dates the bottle to between 1911 and 1929. Next to that, you have a small pill bottle with a V and an M stacked maker's mark, indicating that the bottle was made by Vidiera Monterey Glass Company, which was in Mexico, and it dates to about the 1930s. Next to that, if you have really good eyes, you might be able to read the embossing on the bottom of the white jar, which reads Mentholatum Registered Trademark. And finally, a recognizable blue Vicks Vapor Rub bottle, whose stacked triangular maker's mark indicates that it dates from the 1910s, 20s, or 30s. You probably recognize these as typical medicines used to treat symptoms of respiratory ailments, and the patients at Cragmor also use these to ease their discomfort while they fought the disease. The archaeology also addresses some of the more colorful anecdotes about the sanatorium related to drinking and gambling. For instance, one of the cottages, originally named Marion's Cottage and then later renamed Einstein Cottage, was at one point reported to be a speakeasy and a house of illicit drinking and gambling activities in the 1920s and 30s. This gambling piece on the left offers a tantalizing evidence that the rumors of illegal gambling might very well be true. This was found in the front yard just outside of Marion's Cottage. Additionally, there's ample evidence of alcohol consumption. I just provide two examples here. The middle bottle base clearly indicates that the bottle held wine, with the Owens, Illinois maker's mark indicating that it dates to 1937. And on the right, we have a liquor bottle with a Knox maker's mark from 1958. And if you look closely, maybe you can see the number 133 that I've circled in red, indicating their distiller number. All the bottlers had to be approved if they were bottling alcohol and registered with the government. And they received a distillery number that they printed on the bottom of the bottle. Tobacco was also a popular pastime, maybe perhaps vice, at Cragmor in the early 1900s and 1910s. And here I share two tobacco tins recovered from the grounds. The first, Prince Albert, dates to between 1907 and 1913. And the second is Epicure V tobacco, also patented in 1908. While you may think it odd that patients or doctors at a tuberculosis sanatorium would smoke, studies linking smoking with various lung diseases or cancer weren't widely conducted or shared with the public until the 1950s and 60s. So many of the patients and doctors did smoke during this time. So now I'm going to move a little forward in time to the 1950s. The last decade of the sanatorium was tied to the Navajo tuberculosis epidemic. Navajo patients were flown into Cragmor as part of one of the first public health programs launched by the newly formed Department of Health, Education, and Welfare. A visionary Navajo Tribal Council member named Annie Winnetka was the head of the Navajo Council Committee on Health and Welfare. She worked to improve the health and education of the Navajo patients during this time. And Winnetka coordinated efforts between the U.S. government and the Navajo Nation to solicit governmental help in addressing the TB pandemic that was on the Navajo Nation. And part of her plan involved contracting with TB sanatoriums off the reservation, as the one sanatorium on the Navajo reservation could not handle the volume of patients at the time. In 1952, the Cragmor Foundation signed a contract with this new department and Health and Indian Health Services to treat Navajo women with tuberculosis. And the first patients under this contract began arriving in 1952. These patients were mainly women, as they treated women and men separately to avoid distractions during treatment. With guidance from Winnetka, the managing director, George Dwyer, created a dynamic program for Navajo women and girls, which not only provided for their physical health needs, but also included education and an occupational therapy program run by Virginia Dykstra. And this was part of a more holistic treatment plan. Under the program, Navajo women were classified based on the severity of their illness. If they were deemed well enough, which were classes 3 through 6, they offered education and occupational therapy in keeping with the goals of the Department of Health, Education, and Welfare. One aspect of the educational programs focused on hygiene. This article, called Soapy Weeds, is from one of the patient newsletters at the time called Corn in the Rainbow. This article reveals that Navajo patients preferred to make soap the traditional way, using yucca root. This article also extols the benefits of using yucca root shampoo. The sanatorium supported and sponsored this activity, and by the 1950s, they had denuded the landscape around the bluffs of yucca. They also offered cooking classes to reinforce proper food handling and preparation. The newspaper article here from the Denver Post in 1957 reads that Indian patients at Cragmor Sanatorium bake their favorite Indian fry bread on modern cooking facilities. Below this article is a butter mold from the 1950s found near one of the cottages where they performed these cooking classes. It's not clear whether the mold was directly tied to the cooking program, but it does date to the correct time period and was found in the right location. Another aspect of the occupational therapy run by Dykstra included arts programs. They ranged from traditional weaving, like the rug pictured here, woven by two patients from Cragmor, which is now in the Colorado Springs Fine Arts Center collection. The other arts included things like beading projects using templates like the one pictured here on the right that was from the University Archives collection. This is a template for making key fobs like the ones pictured below from the Colorado Springs Pioneers Museum. Staff from the sanatorium would order beads via mail order from merchants in New Mexico and Arizona for the patients' projects, which is also shown in the picture here. Images like this one here, also from the Navajo patient newsletter, The Corn and the Rainbow, depict the continued importance of traditional medicine. One Cragmor patient article discusses the role of traditional medicine men in treating tuberculosis. Margaret Platero writes in the highlighted area, "Today, many medicine men are still at hand to help those who believe in him. They are proud of their medicine because they know they have saved many lives and will continue to do so. With whatever prayer we believe in, may we go hand in hand with our white neighbors to fight any disease together." In fact, Winnetka was very influential in supporting traditional practices while also facilitating Western treatment for Navajo patients. Based on this illustration and article, it appears that the Navajo patients at Cragmor practice both Western and traditional medicine, perhaps as a way to hedge their bets in their chase for the cure. I hope you found this very brief dive into both the archival and archaeological record of Cragmor Sanatorium as interesting as I have. Before the heavy reliance of pharmaceuticals and even after, people practiced holistic strategies for healthcare that treated the whole person and focused on both mental and physical health. The doctors and patients at Cragmor understood and recognized the importance of promoting both mental and physical health. Moving forward with this research, I would really love to explore these ideas in more depth and focus more attention on the Navajo era of the sanatorium. I would also love to hear from people who had connections to the sanatorium to learn more. Before we entertain questions, you're going to hear briefly from a couple of past and present students. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Dr. Larkin, for that informative presentation. I love seeing all of the different artifacts that you found, and they really do tell a compelling story about the history of the sanatorium. So at this time, we'll be joined by our first panelist. Gwendolyn Swift is a 2018 graduate of UCCS. As an intern in the UCCS University Archives, she created an exhibit on the Navajo era at the sanatorium for the library. Gwendolyn is currently a digital archivist for the U.S. Olympic and Paralympic Committee's Crawford Family U.S. Olympic and Paralympic Archives. Gwendolyn, thank you for chatting with the group this evening. Could you please tell us about your work in the archives at UCCS and how that has helped you in your career?
Hi, everyone. Thanks for being here tonight. As Dean Vidler mentioned, my name is Gwendolyn Swift. I graduated from UCCS in 2018 with my BA in art history, and I minored in museum studies. I'm here to share a bit about an independent study I did in the spring of 2018 as part of my museum studies program. Over the course of a semester, I researched the final chapter of Cragmor's operation using materials in the UCCS archives. By final chapter, I'm talking about the quote unquote Navajo era that concluded Karen's presentation. And this era took place in the 1950s and early 60s, directly before the property was turned over to the University of Colorado. And during this time, of course, the vast majority of patients at Cragmor were Navajo women. In the end, I used the research and the materials in the archives to design a small exhibit that was temporarily displayed in the UCCS library. Going into the process, I knew I wanted the exhibit to share a little known story with the UCCS community, and I wanted to also place it in context in Colorado Springs history. I also wanted to illustrate the sometimes tense interaction between two very different cultures and healing traditions. My research in the archives focused mainly on the Virginia Dykstra collection. And as Karen mentioned, Virginia Dykstra was an occupational therapist at Cragmor during the 1950s and early 1960s. And she was one of the last staff remaining before the facility shut down. As I went through things folder by folder, I learned that the occupational therapy program was a huge part of life at Cragmor for these patients. So I made sure to give it a lot of focus in my exhibit. For example, part of the program was, as Carrie mentioned, creating art like traditional weavings and also beadwork, which isn't a traditional Navajo art like weaving is, but patients became expert at it nonetheless. This is a good segue into mentioning other collections in the Springs that also have materials from this period at Cragmor. I reached out to the Fine Arts Center and the Pioneers Museum, knowing that they might have some of the beadwork and weavings made by patients, which they did. And I think one of the slides Karen showed had a few of those objects for you to see. And I was able to display high-res images of these objects in my exhibit. I'm really grateful I was able to have that experience at UCCS and interact with this piece of history so closely. Which brings me briefly to touching on what I'm doing now. Since June of 2019, as Dean Vidler mentioned, I have been a contract digital archivist at the US Olympic and Paralympic Committee Archives, where I work primarily with the photo collection and with the records and manuscripts. I fulfill research and photo requests from within and without the organization, and I help make the collection more accessible in a digital format. In addition to going through the process of curating an exhibit from start to finish, my independent study is where I got a lot of my basic familiarity with what defines an archives and what archival research means in practice, which is a huge part of my day-to-day now. During my time at UCCS, I also did an internship at the Galleries of Contemporary Art on campus and got exposure to what goes into planning and executing exhibits on a larger scale there. I also interned at the Heller Center for the Arts and Humanities, also on campus, where I got experience working in the specialized kind of museum collection software I currently work in. When I was researching Cragmor, I found out how close you're able to get to history in an archives. I don't feel like I was being told this story. I felt like I was discovering it for myself. And I'm glad I had that opportunity at UCCS and got to put theory into practice with firsthand research. So with that, I'll say thanks to everyone for the opportunity to share a little bit about my own experience of Cragmore's history with you today.
Thank you so much, Gwendolyn. At this point, we'll be joined by Sophia Zanoni. Sophia is a current UCCS student set to graduate in May. Sophia has been working in curation in the anthropology department for Dr. Larkin. Sophia, thank you for connecting this evening. Could you please tell us briefly about your experience working in curation and what skills have you learned as a result?
I would be happy to. So at this point, I have been working in anthropology's curation facility for around 2 years. Generally, my job involves analyzing the archaeological materials from field schools, database entry and management, and general organization of documentation and the curation space itself. My favorite thing about working in curation is probably the flexibility of the job. There's always at least two projects to work on at the same time. So if I don't want to analyze artifacts one day, I can reorganize a part of the collection instead. Overall, working in curation has helped me to develop the skills I'd need to work in a museum or cultural resource management company later on. And it's provided a hands-on experience that isn't available in a typical classroom setting. This job has also helped to develop my general organization, project, and self-management skills, which will be generally applicable to a variety of fields if I don't end up working as an archaeologist. In terms of the project on the Cragmor Sanatorium, my coworker Ulrich and I helped to pull the artifacts related to Cragmor, and we took many of the pictures you saw in Dr. Larkin's presentation. I also helped do some of the research on the use and history of these objects. In particular, what I think is the coolest artifact from this collection is an old chemical bottle for aluminum oxide anhydrous. Generally, I think it's just really aesthetically pleasing, and looking at it really makes me think of period mysteries. But looking into the potential uses of this chemical has been incredibly interesting. From the label, we know that it was used for chromatography, and by talking to faculty in the chemistry department, a better understanding of exactly how this material was used in chromatography can be determined, although we still don't exactly know what it was they were separating chromatographically. Overall, I'd say that this job has been one of the highlights of my college experience, and it's really helped me focus in on what I want to do in the future. So I'm really grateful to Dr. Larkin for providing me the opportunity to work in the curation facility.
Thank you so much, Sophia. Callie Ryan is our final panelist. Callie is a current UCCS student in museum studies and is set to graduate in 2023. She's an intern in the UCCS University Archives with Archives Librarian Mary Rupp. Callie, thanks for being here tonight. What has it been like to work in the archives, and what have you learned?
It's been awesome to work in the archives. I wish I'd gotten more time in the archives. Unfortunately, working during COVID, I've had to switch to digital sources and all that. Luckily, I got to go to the archives for the first time last week, which was really interesting because I got to see all the materials that I've been working with to create my presentation on the remodeling and redevelopment of the Cragmor Sanatorium into what is known as Main Hall today. So I got to see the maps and how it changed through the years. So I've been focusing on the year that it became a college, which was 1965, all the way up to about 1974. And I will also focus on talking about the Disability Act and how that affected the remodeling of Cragmor Manor, which is also known as Main Hall today, which it changed. I'll also talk about that. I will also talk about how it went from a sanatorium to a college and how they had to change a lot of the things with the wiring, and there was a bunch of safety issues, but it's been really wonderful working in the archives. I've learned a lot. I've learned how to use finding aids and how to use sources from the archives and how to use that on a bibliography and how to cite those sources properly, as well as how to properly handle sources from archives. So I've gotten a lot of knowledge, which is really awesome. And it's really awesome that I've gotten it early on to see what I really want to do, if I want to work in the archives at the museum, or if I want to work in curation, or if I want to do education. It's really nice to have a well-balanced just experience in every museum aspect. And so it's been really awesome, and I've gotten a lot of experience, and I've just been really enjoying it. And I love learning about UCCS, especially since I go here. It's so interesting to learn a lot of stuff that I didn't know about before. And it's so interesting to see how the college has changed and shifted over the years and how we are till today.
Thank you so much, Callie. At this point, we'll transition to the question and answer portion of tonight's program. We have a lot of questions rolling in, so we might not get to all of them, but let's get started. So Dr. Larkin, the first question is for you. Is there any part of the sanatorium that still needs to be excavated?
So most of the sanatorium is now sort of underneath the buildings of UCCS, but there are still some areas that have yet to be explored. And one of those is a midden area. And a midden, for those of you who don't speak archaeology, is a large sort of trash pit. And you know, as archaeologists, we love trash pits because we can get a lot of information from people's trash. It's basically what we do. We study people's trash. And so that is one area I would like to test. There's a couple other areas around campus that suggest that they might be related to some alternative healing practices that we'd like to test. But for the most part, it would be a little intrusive for us to go and dig a bunch of holes in the middle of basically the main part of campus. So we probably won't be doing a whole lot of future excavation.
Thank you. Okay, so you all talked about how the sanatorium contracted with the Bureau of Indian Affairs to treat Navajo women with TB. So what happened to the Navajo men? Where did they go?
So they treated the men and the women separately because one of the things that Annie Winnetka found, she was sort of part nurse, part social worker, and part just innovator. She was an amazing woman. But one of the things that she found was that when the men and the women were being treated together at this, in the same facilities, the women spent more of their time taking care of the men than they did taking care of their own health. And so one of her goals was to separate them. And then that also allowed the sanatorium to do sort of targeted education and occupational therapy programs for the women.
That's interesting. Thank you so much. Okay, so we're going to go to some of the questions submitted during the presentation. So this question is, I would love to know what has been most surprising in your research?
So I think one of the most surprising things I've seen in the research is how little things have actually changed today. When we're looking at recommendations for how we deal with COVID, I'm hearing the same sorts of sort of therapies, whole person treatment therapies that they were using back then. So this idea that we should get out, get some fresh air, walk around, take care of our mental health. I guess one of the surprising things is the parallels that I'm seeing. The bottle that Sophia mentioned is in beautiful, pristine condition. And one of the surprising things for me has been is how difficult it is to figure out sort of exactly what they were using that for. We have a general idea, it's used to separate proteins and things like this, but I don't know exactly what they're using it for in relation to tuberculosis. So if anybody knows, maybe I see there's a few people in the chat who might have some information that they could share with me that I would love to hear. And then the other thing is just how personal some of these artifacts sort of make the experience. So one of the things that I've recently discovered was I had a little bottle that had a maker's mark on the bottom of it that wasn't a glass company maker's mark. So it took me a little while to figure out what the maker's mark was. And it turns out that it's a maker's mark for artist's paint that they imported from New York City. So it was a tiny little paint shop, a high-end, sort of nice paint shop for professional artists in New York City that ran in the 19 teens. And this little bottle made its way here, and it really sort of brought home the fact that there are artists actually living and working here while they're recovering. So that's just a few of the things.
Those are great. Thank you so much. Okay, so here's a question about the term, your use of the term occupational therapy. So is that a term that was used at the time, or are you suggesting how the past activity of the traditional Navajo arts as part of the treatment, how that activity fits in this more current framing? So I'm curious because I'm wondering if occupational art therapy was identified as such in the period that you research.
So occupational therapy is a term they used. And in fact, there's a document in the university archives that lays out all of the goals of the occupational therapy program. So that is available if somebody's interested, I can sort of help them learn more about that.
Super. Okay, so here's another question. With our use of recycling and waste removal, do you think the archaeologists of the future will study us?
So I will say I actually do an assignment in my class, in my intro to archaeology class, asking pretty much that exact same question. I have people sort of go through their own trash for a day or a week, depending on whether or not, you know, how long the class is. And I have them sort of categorize everything, make interpretations, and then tell me what it is that's not represented in that trash. So what is it that they recycled or, you know, didn't make it into the actual trash can? Maybe it went other places, like, I don't know, down the toilet, if you have babies or whatever. And so what doesn't get represented in the trash definitely affects how, you know, we're able to make these interpretations. And recycling is nothing new. They've been doing recycling forever. And in fact, bottles were recycled for quite a long time. So, you know, you see some of these liquor bottles, and while they couldn't officially refill them, people would, you know, reuse them. You would see this also with, probably if you go into your own china cabinet, you might have dishes from your grandmother or something, these heirlooms that are getting passed down and recycling. So it definitely does sort of change how we're able to make interpretations, but we know that people do these things. And so we can sort of build these into how we make our interpretations.
Right, that's fascinating.
And the other thing I would say is that people actually throw away a lot more than they think they do. So I always get, oh, you know, I'm really good at recycling, but I was surprised at how much trash I had. So
so true. Thank you so much, Dr. Larkin, and thank you so much to all our panelists and for everybody who tuned in tonight. This has been an amazing presentation. I want to remind people to please join UCCS for the third lecture in this series, which will take place on Saturday, April 10th at 2 p.m. in a Zoom webinar entitled Exploring Our Urban Forest, in partnership with the Colorado Springs Pioneers Museum. This presentation will feature Dr. Christine Bierman, Assistant Professor in the UCCS Geography and Environmental Studies Department, and Dennis Willis of the Colorado, who is the Colorado Springs City Forester. So please visit www.uccs.edu/150th for more information. Thank you so much for joining us this evening, and good night.